I want to talk about the new Vermintide 2 expansion today, but I didn't end up reviewing the base game like I wanted to when it came out, so I want to give some thoughts on the series before expansion talk. Timestamp on screen if you just want to skip straight to the Winds of Magic review. Vermintide is a Left 4 Dead 'em up made by Fat Shark, and these two games are genuinely great fun. The first is an interesting take and meaningful evolution of its predecessor's formula with a thick coating of Warhammer Fantasy flavor on top. It's fun to call the game Left 4 Dead with rats, but it's more ambitious than that. It takes its setting and uses it to make a lot of cool mechanical changes, like the increased emphasis on skillful melee combat and ammo conservation. It's also a great example of how to integrate RPG elements into an existing formula in a way that adds depth rather than just grind, since equipment loadouts drastically change the way you play. And the character interactions are top-notch. The Vermintide gang is tons of fun to hear talk. I only got into the first game once its heyday was over, but I had a great time with it. Vermintide 2 added a lot more class customization, new special abilities, and more mini-bosses and enemy types, namely the Norska. Some might consider it a straight upgrade to the original. I think the game is loads of fun, and I've gotten plenty of time out of it, but I dislike a number of design decisions here. While class customization is better, gear customization feels much worse. In the first game, getting a great weapon drop was cause to change your entire playstyle, making loot and the grinding of that loot feel a lot more valuable. A Carillion with a homing bow plays much differently than a Carillion with a swift bow. Vermintide 2, on the other hand, removed a lot of the active weapon enchantments in exchange for passive enchantments. Carillion doesn't have homing bows anymore, that ability instead being tied to a particular class setup and on a strict cooldown. As a result, grinding high difficulty endgame missions feels less rewarding, because you customize your loot to your build rather than the other way around. Try to roll attack speed and crit on everything you have, that's about as complex as Vermintide 2's gear gets. I also dislike the change in map design. Vermintide 1's maps are tight and linear, with a few branching paths in certain areas, keeping the pace quick and tension high, a lot of detailed city streets and interesting locations. The second game's maps have a lot more wide open space and optional areas, leading to much more aimless wandering and getting jabbed in the back by random stragglers. There's no new map in Vermintide 2 which rivals the Horn of Magnus or Wizard's Tower from the first game. The level design in 2 also makes funneling and controlling enemy hordes much harder to accomplish, and leads to items being slapped all over the place rather than placed in particular ways to curb the difficulty. Speaking of which, the optional tomes and grimoires you can pick up for some extra experience are much more of a pain in the ass in this game. Beyond the open level design making them a chore to pick up even if you know where they are, they're much more difficult to get in general. I'd say tomes in this game are about as hard to get as grimoires were in the last game, and grimoires in this game are placed in ridiculous spots no one would find without help. The sheer amount of stupid precision platforming you have to do to collect the books in this game makes every single map run that slight bit more irritating, as your team misses tiny platforms over and over. Vermintide 2 was also unforgivably buggy at launch. Everyone hated getting queued into the final map because the final boss had about a 50-50 chance of glitching out and becoming unkillable, which was horrible after going through without a doubt the longest map in the game. Even before that, the halfway point mini-boss of the map would sometimes bug out and spawn twice for some reason. Both of these happened to me something like 3 times in a row. The game also mysteriously lacks a few features that were added in patches for the first game, namely the arena-style survival game mode. And selling a handful of Vermintide 1 maps back to us, despite Left 4 Dead 2 including all of its first game's maps for free at launch, was scummy. The atmosphere of the game is also lesser, the easy example being the first game's warm, cozy tavern being replaced by a massive, empty fortress. It sounds petty, but the hub area is supposed to feel like a relieving place to be after going through missions, and the tavern does this job so much better. But regardless of all of my complaints, Vermintide 2 still has the viscerally satisfying melee combat, intense horde rushes, character interactions, and aesthetic that made the first one so enjoyable, and the more active player base doesn't hurt either. Anyway, Winds of Magic. Winds of Magic is kind of a trash fire. Not for lack of effort or because the content is even bad, because it's not. It's because the implementation of that content is so slapdash and poorly thought out that the primary draw of the expansion is borderline unplayable. The main draw of Winds of Magic are the Weaves, essentially challenge maps based around 8 different types of magic. You play through a chunk of a map backwards and then fight a few waves of enemies in an enclosed location while dealing with a special condition themed around that map's particular color of magic. The first five weaves, for example, are themed around green magic, which causes dead enemies to spawn thorny bushes on the ground that will slow and damage you if you walk through them. In weaves, you collect essence, which can be used to craft and customize gear that you use exclusively in weaves. Despite the blatant reuse of assets, it's a cool setup. Playing through maps backwards is disorienting and engaging, and the magic conditions are fun to play around with, because not only do they affect you, they affect enemies as well. In blue weaves, lightning will occasionally charge up around each member of the party and then lock position before striking. You could just keep moving and safely dodge the lightning, but you can also wait until the last second to dodge and bait enemies into the area of effect. Some weaves do this better than others, but it's rewarding to turn a disadvantage into an advantage as you come to better understand each effect. My favorite of these is the light magic effect, which reduces your max health over time, but also increases your attack speed. You can camp on special shrines to undo this effect, but keeping yourself at low health and becoming a lawnmower is super satisfying. The gear customization also fixes a huge issue with the game, albeit only within weaves. You craft your own items and can specialize every single stat on your equipment right down to the percentages, meaning you don't have to waste time or materials rolling new stats on your swords. Take the Swift Slaying perk for a weapon and you can ensure that it has the max amount of attack speed and crit chance possible to capitalize on that perk. You can even collect the currency used for upgrades by playing normal maps, not just weaves. This is how the gear should work for the entire game. Like I said, loot drops in this game are already unexciting compared to the first, so I'd prefer to have strict control over my equipment and stats so that I can safely experiment with new builds, rather than having to hope I get 5% crit chance instead of 3% crit chance. Winds of Magic also includes a new map and a new enemy faction, the Beastmen. The new map is fine, it's a typical Vermintide 2 map. There's very little to say about it other than that. Some might complain that only one map in a $20 expansion is too little, but the map is clearly a formality meant to introduce the Beastmen and Weaves, the actual focus of the expansion, so I don't mind it. The Beastmen as enemies are a solid addition. Their specials include big-ass armored bulls, archers, dudes who plant banners to buff nearby enemies, and a new mini-boss, the Minotaur. The only real standout of the group is the Banner Boy, since it's the only one that introduces a new dynamic, wherein you're encouraged to dash past the horde and dance around the big boy to smash the banner first. That said, while the rest aren't outstanding, they do add more variety, which is nice. My issues with the Beastmen lie in two areas, volume and aesthetics, issues they share with the Norska. First, the Skaven still absolutely have the highest number and variety of specials compared to the other two factions. Despite the Norska being front and center on the game's cover, they're still inferior to the Skaven in terms of amount of content and quality of design, and the Beastmen are no different. Beastmen getting this big introductory map all for themselves feels forced when they're not nearly as good as the Skaven. Second, the Beastmen just aren't interesting to look at. The Skaven are colorful and varied, you can instantly tell each kind apart. The Beastmen, and Norska as well, just kinda look like fucked up naked dudes with swords and mud all over them. Only the larger Beastmen, the Bestigors and Minotaurs, are easily distinguishable, and that's because they're huge. On top of that, they blend in far too easily with the Norska. In a horde comprised of both Beastmen and Norska stacked on top of one another, it's impossible to tell them apart. Ultimately, it is nice to have more enemy variety in the game, but it's disappointing that the far and away best faction in the game is still the one that was already in the first game, and that remains almost entirely unchanged from the first game. There are also a few new weapons in the game, one for each hero. They're fine. You left click and they swing at the enemies and the enemies fall down. Again, more variety is nice, but I find it hard to get excited that Carillion can now have a shield or that Saltspire can now use a hook. And to get all of them, you have to clear the new map with every single hero. It's like I'm playing a Yoko Taro game. I have to do everything 5 times before I get to play. The level cap was increased from 30 to 35, but there are no new talents associated, so there's absolutely nothing to be gained from reaching the new max except commendation chests. Not sure what that's about. I think maybe there were supposed to be new talents, but they decided against it. Maybe? I don't know. Oh yeah, and there's a new highest difficulty setting, Cataclysm, which is nice for those who want it, but locking it behind a $20 expansion instead of just adding it into the base game is ridiculous. All it does is crank up enemy health and damage and increase spawn rates. That's it. Why does that cost money? You could probably find the exact same thing for free on the modded servers right now. So how is this a trash fire, you ask? It all seems fine, maybe a bit pricey, but fine. Well, it's kinda unplayable. Not because of bugs or server issues, but because the matchmaking for the Weaves, the main draw of the expansion, is batshit insane. There are 120 Weaves in total. I've reached Weave 23 at time of writing and can't progress further. Not for lack of playtime or effort, but because every single Weave has its own matchmaking queue. The game's relatively small player base, which remains below 10,000 on an average day, is being divided even further to separate those who own the expansion and those who don't. And that small fraction of that small player base is being divided among 120 different matchmaking queues. The amount of time I've wasted sitting around alt-tabbed while waiting for a party is staggering. Now you may wonder, why not just play with bots? You can play the normal maps with bots, why not do that with Weaves? The answer to which is, you can't. Fat Shark have deemed, in their infinite wisdom, that you're not allowed to have AI teammates in Weaves. I assume this is because the Weaves become progressively more difficult as they go on, and the devs decided bots wouldn't be capable of taking on the harder Weaves. Not sure how having no teammates at all is easier than having bots though, guys. I did eventually manage to get a full party to attempt Weave 23, but the game boosts up to champion difficulty starting at Weave 20, meaning harder enemies and friendly fire. Weave 20 is also when the death magic Weaves begin, the only Weave condition I've played but not yet figured out how to use against enemies. Weave 23 pits you against 3 bile trolls in a row. You're starting to see why I haven't completed Weave 23. After about the 10th failed attempt, the party split up out of frustration, and I was left waiting and waiting and waiting for another party. Nothing quite like incredibly difficult challenges combined with incredibly poor matchmaking. And so I gave up. You could say that Weaves are intended to be played with full parties of 4 who know one another and are using voice to communicate, but that wouldn't excuse the poor matchmaking even if it were realistic. I wanted this to be a positive video. Really, I did. And I want every opportunity I can to recommend the Vermintide games, because they're great. Don't take this video as a recommendation against playing Vermintide 2. But I can't recommend an expansion which feels so blatantly mishandled. The content feels good in theory, but theory is all I have, because the piss-poor matchmaking makes difficult but doable challenges into practically insurmountable ones. Don't buy Winds of Magic. Not unless they radically overhaul the matchmaking system, or you can get it for cheap. If you have money burning a hole in your pocket, buy the game's map packs instead. Or buy the game for a friend. Or draw dicks on the money and mail it to Fat Shark's offices. Up to you, really. Man, I did not expect this video to be such a downer. I really am trying to make more positive videos, and I thought this one would be a shoo-in when I bought the expansion. But thankfully I've got another video lined up and in the works, and I'm feeling damn good about the game in question, so stick around for that and we'll turn things around again. Also, I made a Twitter, so you guys can see how funny my jokes are and maybe get updates on videos if you'd like. Link is in the description.